Hey, elementary kids, it's Jeremy from Kids City. Let me ask you a question. If you committed a sin with your hands, maybe you pushed your sister or took something from your brother that belonged to them instead of you, how long would you have to wash in order to get that sin off? A minute? 2 minutes? 5 minutes? Well, if you answered 2 minutes, you're wrong. You're obviously wrong. Obviously, none of those answers are correct. In fact, you cannot wash any amount of time and get sin off, because that's not how it works. But as crazy as that might seem, there were people in Jesus' time that kind of thought like that. They believed that if they could get everyone to be clean enough and do the right stuff, that God would see them and be impressed and save them. And today we're going to see what happens when Jesus, the one true Savior, actually confronts their false beliefs. So let's jump into the book of Matthew, chapter 15. In it, we see the Pharisees coming to Jesus with what might seem like an innocent question to us, but it's actually meant as a trap intended to turn people against Jesus. In verse 2, they ask, "Why do your disciples break the traditions of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat." Now let's point out something real quick. The disciples weren't trying to be gross. People in those days, in fact, didn't know anything about germs. And so washing your hands actually had nothing to do with avoiding disease. Instead, this was actually a tradition passed down by the Pharisees themselves. But quick question, who are the Pharisees? The Pharisees are a group of religious leaders who wanted to see God's promised Messiah come and save the people of Israel from the Roman Empire, or at least that's how they started. So in order to make that happen, they decided to add to God's law, making even normal Israelites follow rules like ceremonial washing that were really only intended for priests. But God created these laws about ceremonial washing not because it would actually remove sin, but because it would show how sin makes us unclean and unworthy of coming before the Lord. So let's think about that for a moment. The Pharisees created extra laws, which they called traditions, and made people follow them in order to be considered good enough for God to send his Messiah. Then they got mad at the disciples of Jesus, the one true Messiah, for not following their traditions. How crazy is that? But you know, Jesus actually responds in a really cool way. In verses 3-6, it says, "He answered them, 'And why do you break the commandments of God for the sake of your traditions? For God commanded, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father and mother must surely die. But you say, if anyone tells his father or his mother, what you would have gained from me is given to God, he need not honor his father.'" So the Pharisees weren't just adding to God's law. They were actually replacing it with their own. Jesus quotes the second of the Ten Commandments, honor your father and your mother. One of the ways that people did that in that day was by providing for their parents once their parents were too old to work. They didn't have retirement plans in that day, so people relied on their children to take care of them in their old age. But you see, the Pharisees had created a loophole where they could say that they had given all that they had to God through offering it to the temple of God. But here's the thing, the Pharisees are the ones who got to benefit from those offerings. So it was like they were stealing money that was meant to be taking care of their aging parents and keeping it for themselves. The rules and traditions they had created let them ignore the laws God had set before them. Even though the Pharisees acted like they were being holy, Jesus showed everyone how evil their hearts really were. Now, sadly, there are a lot of people in Christianity who do this. My whole life, I've seen people who use the commands of God to justify themselves, or they use God's commands to tell other people what to do, all while ignoring God's commands that they themselves don't like. But God makes it repeatedly clear that he judges our heart, not just our actions. And so the thing is, we can do all the good stuff that we want, but if we don't truly love God and love others, we can never truly be good enough. And the thing is, we're all selfish and we're all sinful people. All of us choose not to be loving towards God and others from time to time. So really, none of us could ever be good enough for God. Fortunately, there was one person that was good enough, Jesus Christ, because he is God in human form. Therefore, he was the only perfect person to live and became the only sacrifice perfect enough to cover all the sins of mankind. And now, because of his sacrifice, we get to be forgiven of our own failure to live up to God's law by trusting in Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Today's big picture question is, can we ever be good enough for God? And the answer is no, but God's grace extends to those who trust in him. So make sure you guys take a minute and check out the Kids City Praise videos this week, as well as a breakdown of today's lesson in the Family Worship Guide down below. Hope everyone is staying safe, and we'll see you next time.